Some practitioner said to me, you know, Ethan, you know, new power, new guy coming in, Hu Jintao. You know, you better hurry your research up. You better be done in the next 3 or 4 months because the persecution's going to end now. And that was about 2 years ago. This is not about one man. It never will be. This is about a system.
My view about the Communist Party actually came a long way since my childhood. My father died in the Cultural Revolution because of the persecution by the local authorities. And he was persecuted because of writing a letter for one innocent villager that complained about their life. And he was persecuted to death. And that gave my family, you know, a really a big blow, and their life at that time was very hard.
At that time, Mao Zedong was quite old and a little confused. They must do some things to wash away all the old things, and then they began to do the bad things, to clean all the Western things, old things, including those good things.
When I was in the childhood, you know, we were all educated that Communist Party is good, is the unique organization, unique a party that can truly represent the people's will. Even now that most Chinese people believe in such a doctrine that the Communist Party is the unique party that truly represents the people and serve the people.
Friends, they may wonder if it's true, but I think normal people cannot get these things, you cannot touch it.
The impression that I had on China when I was living in China is very different from the impression that I got while I was living overseas. Both my dad and mom worked for the government. So we were raised with a notion that the authorities are always right. We were told that we needed to appreciate the government for everything that we had. They got us too into this a better and better life. That's how, you know, I was trained to think. And that's what I believed.
In the 1950s, Chairman Mao initiated a great leap forwards because he think that he has the great command over the economy. He has many people that are willing to commit to socialism, so he initiated reform. If he can motivate the people, then everything was possible. He think that the wages, the salary, the bonus, that sort of thing are nonsense. So he tried to motivate them by using the political campaigns. By asking the people to selfishly commit to the socialism's ideal. They ignored the production of the food, and as a result of that, many people starved to death. To a certain extent, Chairman Mao has lost his power in at the end of the 1950s. It was the Liu Xiaoqi who had took up the power. He tried to slow down everything. He tried to give time to the peoples to recover from the setback of the economy. And to a certain extent, to a great extent, he succeeded. And the economy will recover. Everything was getting back to normal. But Chairman Mao at that time thought that this is not the right way to socialism. He thought that Liu Xiaoqi had betrayed the missions of the socialism. So we start the Cultural Revolutions. We emphasize the importance of human beings, the initiative.
Our education taught us not to have such things.
The doctrine of Marxism is about the class struggle. When they finished the opposition of in China, the Kuomintang, the national government, they now turn gun to the people. They have never stopped the campaign, political campaign, from the establishment of the communist government in 1949. And millions of people died in this campaign, in the name of revolution, in the name of serving the people, contributing to the people. They need people to understand it, that the killing is good for the society. And so the Communist Party is against humanity. So Hu Jintao, Deng Xiaoping, all these people are dictators. They are not elected. They are put by special group, the special interest group. And they cannot represent the will of the people. Of course, they can never represent the advancement of the social development as they claim. And one, it's a big issue, huh?
I first went to 1972 during the Cultural Revolution, around the time that President Nixon had gone to China and the ping pong team had gone to China. And it was much more repressive then, and it continued to be very repressive until after Mao died in 1976. And then there was a very slow, partial change in the treatment of dissidents and religion that then went on from, say, the late 1970s up to now. But it has been very slow, and to use the word partial doesn't really explain. I mean, it's still a very repressive place. And as I say, there are certain subjects dealing with religion and minority ethnic peoples, which are totally off limits.
There is no single regime in human history has such a tight control over its people. You know, if you look at the Soviet Union, if you look at Nazi Germany, they're all evil, you know, regime. But comparing to the Chinese Communist Party, they there's like a lot of things much worse, much, much worse inside China.
Shortly after the communists take over, many countries were very reluctant to establish economic relationship with China. And so it was only after, you know, the PRC was established for about 20 years before the US and Japan and other countries began to establish formal diplomatic tie with China.
Communist government is a dictatorship. It's a continuation of feudal system. It's when I was in the middle school, I have thought of what kind of revolution can launched by the Mao Zedong, Chairman Mao Zedong. I always think that it was just a peasant uprising. It's just for the purpose of taking power. It's so the peasants had been used by the Communist Party.
I think he's great. Of course, he saved all the Chinese people. When he was old, made some huge mistakes, makes all the Chinese people suffer. Denied his contribution or mistakes.
Deng saw what had happened during the Cultural Revolutions. He thought it totally absurd what Chairman Mao did in terms of economics developments. So he tried to introduce the market. To a certain extent, Deng Xiaoping's reform succeeded in allowing people to have more economic freedom. But he did not change the political system in China. They are still using the same political system as what Chairman Mao had used for 20 years or 30 years. So you can see that they are running on an uneven basis, particular performance in terms of economic development, but you have a stagnant growth in terms of political reforms.
Corruption become an inevitable political consequence of rapid economic liberalization. And there is no mechanism to address this problem, and people cannot speak out. People have no right even to engage lawyers of their own choice to defend their rights.
Although the government said that they want to have rule of law, but the court, the judges in the court were appointed by the officials. So everything is under the party control. When there is no accountability, the official usually will abuse the system.
At that time, there's no choice for the graduates. If you want to live in China, the government allocated a job for the university graduate. So I was allocated to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and Ministry of Foreign Affairs, yes. And after, you know, I was I got the job in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, I started to know more about the outside world. And And I was at that time, I was quite eager to go overseas. So I applied for many times and was allowed to go to Fiji in 1994.
One of the questions was, are you a member of the Communist Party or the Fascist Party or something like that? And I was shocked and I asked my dad, so how could they put the two together? Because we always, we knew that, you know, the Nazis or Fascists, are, you know, they were bad, they killed a lot of people. But I didn't realize that in the eye of Western society, you know, Communist Party is mentioned in the same breath as other parties.
So that's why they want to change Falun Gong, you know. They want to change practitioners to give up their beliefs.
Oh, yeah.
And they said they can do it. They think they can do it. Even the, in the beginning of, in 1950s to 1980s, they tried very hard to ask all the religious, you know, people to give up their beliefs. Destroy the temples, destroy the churches, organize the Christians, Catholics, teach them the party doctrine, try to control, spiritually control the people.
Mm.
And they have never stopped trying to control the people's spirit. So that's the one major feature of a dictatorship.